So happy to see so many faces in the crowd today. Welcome to DigitalOcean Berlin's very first meetup. Give yourself a round of applause for coming here. Yay! Awesome. So we're really excited to be here today. Thank you, Factory Berlin, for hosting us, home of the largest startup campus in Germany. We're looking forward to doing more with the factory this year. So today we have a really interesting program. We have the DigitalOcean engineering team here with us. We have engineers from America, we have engineers from Canada, we have engineers from Brazil, from Germany. So all in the crowd, if you see us in the DigitalOcean t-shirt, come up and say hello to us. One of the main reasons why we're here today is to kick off this global meetup series in Berlin. What I'm looking to do this year is to empower developers around the world to host meetups like this one by local developers for local developers. So I know that my colleagues were in Berlin last year hosting a bunch of events on behalf of DigitalOcean when our Frankfurt data center launched. And it sounded like they had a brilliant time. So I joined DigitalOcean maybe like 6 months ago and I was like, that sounds like a fun market to have an event in. So I'm gonna go there and check out the community. So I'm here to host this very first event and hopefully we'll be able to pass this on to someone or someones out here in the crowd in the next few months so that you could kick off this event and you have this event month after month after month. And what we're really hoping to see is to have this event be by your community, for your community. We're just here to kick off the very first event and to listen to what you have to tell us, DigitalOcean, to you're our customers. We want to hear what you love about our product, what you don't love about our product. Come grab any one of us and tell us how we can make your experience better as developers, because that's what we're here to do, make your developer experiences better. So with that said, I'm going to pass my mic off to Dave, who's going to jump into the first talk. We're going to have 3 talks today. And after each talk, we're going to have a brief Q&A. And after all the talks, we're going to have more networking time, more burger and drinks time. So come and chat with all of us anytime. Thank you.
Good evening. So tonight, I want to start by talking about a problem that's pretty near and dear to my heart these days, which is having multiple systems that are written in entirely different languages provably interact correctly. So specifically in the context of integration testing. Who am I? I'm Dave Worth. I'm a software engineer at DigitalOcean, working on a complicated team that does fun things, sometimes fun things. But in that work, lately, I've had a pretty standard story. We start building a thing, we choose some languages we like, we probably build some APIs, some services, maybe some clients, and they work together. And then something really great happens. Yay, we launch. This thing works really well. We hopefully make a lot of money, which is often the goal. Yeah. But then we realize that we don't know what our thing does. We have a heap of data, hopefully we're doing some great logging, we're doing something, and we can't actually understand user churn, or user behaviors, or billing patterns, or all these things that are really important, and somebody very smart says, maybe we need a data science team. The problem is the data science team probably doesn't use the same tools you used to build the fun thing in the first place. If you used Python in the first place, great. If you used R, great. If you did not, and you chose Ruby, or Go, or COBOL, or whatever you want to implement things in, then you have a little bit of a problem when it comes to actually integrating them together. And pretty often, and this is actually near and dear to my heart because I'm doing exactly this, working with the data science team at work, writing Ruby clients for Python things. You know, a classifier ends up being a giant array, essentially. And a giant array is static, and that's kind of cool, but you have to somehow provide access to that. You'll probably have some sort of API in front of it. So there are some complications here. Depending on how you're communicating this API, you may have unstructured data like JSON, or effectively unstructured, potentially changing up underneath you the data going to and from the API, and your clients or APIs may break contracts. In theory, you know, we usually solve this with testing. In Ruby, you use RSpec, in Python, you use PyUnit. You choose your tooling, but if one piece is in Ruby and one piece, or one piece is in Go, and one piece is in Python, that becomes less easy. For those of you familiar with RSpec, one of the solutions is we'll usually use WebMock, and WebMock can say, point to this rack application to make sure that whatever is connecting to it is actually talking to the live application. can't do that so much with the Python API, for instance.
So what can we do?
We can test them together. We can use Docker, wrap up things on the left with things on the right, and some combination. General idea. What are we going to do? We're going to write a test in one test of, say, an API in one language using standard idioms of that language. You want to write a test, a tested client in another language, and then you want to test them together. You want to make sure that the assumptions you make on the client are actually true to the API and vice versa. And then you want to do this by, you want to be able to connect with yourself and do it relatively fast. We all hate slow testings. So, general idea in a contrived example, a Ruby client on the left, a Flask API on the right, and maybe some backing persistence stores. Who knows? We shouldn't know. The client shouldn't know in particular, and shouldn't care. So what you can do easily is expose specific things to the client. You can show the client, you can actually use the client itself and the API live. The API needs to now talk to things that are not exposed to it. Oh, and one important thing, you should configure the client probably by environment variables, you know, standard 12-factor application stuff, which makes some of these dynamic things we want to do easy. So what exactly are we going to do now that I've used a lot of words and talked very quickly and said very little about how this works? So in particular, I have a very simple Flask API. It literally returns a JSON message that says hello, and that's it. And of course, we can test this in Python and make some assertions about the structure of it, that it actually returns JSON and that it's properly encoded JSON, or with the structure we expect. That's fine. And we can do something also in our client that looks very similar. We can write an incredibly simple client method, and behind that, the base class is just standing up an HTTP client, nothing special. And what we want are tests that look like regular RSpec tests. Standard testing for any Ruby project. But what are we testing against? What is this actually fundamentally testing? Well, we want to test against a live version of the API. And how can we accomplish that? We accomplish that by standing up a live copy of the API. So, very simple. Before the entire suite runs, stand up a new instance of the integral API and use a bind it to an ethereal port. So we just leave this blank. And we'll let Docker machine assign us a port. We can do something incredibly ugly to walk down this JSON tree and figure out what port that actually is. I am entirely in the way with these folks. We can find out the IP, and we can expose the URL of the API to the client. And this all happens before the test suite actually spins up. Now, there is this kind of horrendous thing, which I'm not proud of, and I wouldn't really want anyone to see. But the problem is, even if the container boots extremely quickly, in which the API lives, the API itself may take some time to boot. And that's what we're accounting for here. And we probably only want to do this if we're in development mode. Like, if we're just running on the console. We probably don't want to do this in CI. Also not beautiful, but it works. So what does this actually do for us? I can use my incredibly long prompt to run the specs just as we normally would. Super cool. So we run some tests. We actually have everything. We actually have done it against a working container here. And we have to make some assertions. Now, this is nice, I guess. We didn't have to do this locally. But how does this work in CI? Well, the good news is drone CI is a nice containerized continuous integration environment. It also works on Docker and has effectively a version of Docker Compose within it. So all we have to do is say, please spin up a copy of the API, expose the URL. Everything in Docker is on localhost, so we can make some assertions. We know up front what the configuration of the URL will be. And we can run it in Drone as well, using the exact same tests and the exact same structure. This is incredibly slow. I had intended to do this before we even started talking, but we'll wait for a minute. And while that's happening. Okay. on an earlier version of the code so we can talk about what happened when you actually had persistence layers as well. And should have one. There. The actual exciting part happens now. From within the container, we're seeing the exact same tests. And in this case, instead of hitting an instance of the API running in a container locally, you're running it in Docker. Or, sorry, in Drone. So that's kind of exciting. Now, what happens if we want to do persistence layers? I mentioned I showed Postgres, I showed Redis. No one should know what those things actually are. But if we look again at a newer version of the API, now we have a Redis-backed API that has a single simple route to increment a counter in Redis. It doesn't do much, but it does do something. And the tests, again, look very similar. Now we can actually say something about the contents of Redis, which is nice. We have the client, but we still have to look at the client and how that works. And the tests look, the client looks incredibly similar. And the tests look very, very similar as well. But now we have to make some funny assertions. What's going on here? I'm checking to make sure that two consecutive calls have the same value, or it's consecutive integer values. That's nice, but why do we have to do that? Well, we want to assert on the first time, the first time you hit the API, you get back one, and the second time you get back two. You also can't control the order of your specs potentially. You don't know who's come before you and hit the same Redis store. These are true integration specs. Now, you may also say, cool, then just reset Redis, reach in there, tell Redis what the state should be, and make some assertions then, but now you're leaking an abstraction. Now you know too much about the API, but all you want to do is test the client. So, same general story. In this case, we've spun up, instead of just the API, we also start a Redis container, and we wait for it. And what does it actually look like to do that in this case? Oh, my alarm went off. Great. Sorry. There's the humor part. So, in this case, it looks very similar to before, but I've replaced a lot of kind of painler, I'll stop going quickly, painful boilerplate with a single call to start the API container. And we're doing that in container management. And it's very simple. It stands up Redis. It stands up the API. And it also knows how to shut down, which we do after the suite. So this looks a lot like Docker Compose. Yes, absolutely. But it has a few advantages. So the demo actually worked. That never happens. So what are the caveats here? So what are the downsides? Well, we have to wait for it. Wait for the container, which isn't great. So we talk about how blazing fast containers are to spin up, but yet we have a sleep. You can do something clever, like pull the application if there's a health endpoint. If that's a problem, it may not be. That's 0.3 seconds at the beginning of a test suite in a Ruby or Rails app is actually not much to worry about. Seeding data, we'll say. Don't do it. There's been many, many, many attempts to make remote factory girls or all these different tools to remotely seed APIs, and it ends up being a mess. Treat it like a true integration test. Treat it like a live API because it is one. If there needs to be data there, use the API to put it there, or replicate production in such a way that however the data arrives in production, it arrives in your test suite. So there are definitely other paths. I showed this to colleagues, and the first thing they said is just call Docker Compose, spin up all your services, let it tear it back down. Sure, totally works. In many ways, I had a good excuse to mess with Swipely's Docker API gem, which was fun. Not always so pretty to wait for the entire Docker Compose story to launch, because it is a little bit slower. It could be fine. You could also just simply run everything in Drone, right? Why do you have all this machinery in RSpec, push it to CI, let it happen? That's true. But it is also unbelievably slow to boot Drone itself. So you may have to wait for that. It's fine for a CI story, but not so good for testing with a rapid feedback loop. So, any questions? Thank you very much.
Up next, we have Brian Miles. I always like to kind of mix up the tech meetups. It's so technical. I also like to give a little bit of like personality, a little bit of background on the speakers as well. So when you're chatting with them later, they're not just talking about development. So a little bit about Dave. Dave enjoys great food, cycling, great beer, and great friends. Up next, we have Brian Miles. He likes to build robots, race cars in straight lines and around turns, and build devices and stuff, in addition to talking to you all. So, welcome, Brian.
Hello, hello. So, Samantha alluded to our trip here last year, and I actually was the only person, I guess, here that attended last year, and I have to say one thing about Berlin. People talk about great cities, and like, you need to do tech, let's go to San Francisco. I personally don't like San Francisco. I like Berlin, but I think that I like Berlin between April and whenever it gets cold. if you notice that I timed my trips here, I'm coming in April. I'm not going to see you all in February, or December, or January, but April through, let's say, September, October, I think it's pretty cool. So what I'm going to talk about today is, once I find my talks here, is something a little bit different. I found that the way to be considered an expert in something is just to invent your own thing. So I'm going to talk about something you've never heard about before, but the whole topics, all the topics will be very, very comfortable and very, very familiar to people who are deploying applications. So what I like to call this is app ops in action. And today I'm going to think about continuous delivery. A whole bunch of buzzwords, that was the issue in the door, and we'll see what happens. So I have an agenda. I think every good conference talk should have an agenda. Sometimes I put the agenda in reverse. Sometimes I just put the summary first in case people want to tune out and get on their laptops. But today you're actually going to have to listen to hear what's going to happen at the end. So what's our agenda? We're going to do goals, what, where, how, rolling with the homies, why, and then. And that's what we're going to talk about today. So who am I? I'm a software engineer. My name is Brian Miles. I actually do work at DigitalOcean. The cool fact about Brian Miles is everyone else here you're going to hear from today is in engineering. But I'll tell you what I do for a living. I actually have two products at DigitalOcean. I'm not in engineering. One of them is open source. I spend 80% of my time writing open source, and I'm in sales. So if you really want to win at companies, you actually need to join the sales organization and move away from engineering. That's a pro tip. So like I said, I work at DigitalOcean, and I want to talk about a few things here. One of the things is that we feel that we're on a mission, and you know, I found this here because I actually do love the Blues Brothers movie, A Mission from God. If you don't believe in any type of thing, you can replace God with $deity, whatever, praise science, doesn't matter. But we're on a mission from God right now. And what I mean is that DigitalOcean is on a mission from God. We're here to deliver three things that are really up on our pipeline. The first thing is storage. We started off 4 years ago with a compute product. And that compute product allows you to do compute things. We provided you with networking, and we provided you with memory, we provided you with CPU, and we provided you with disk. And guess what? To this day, over 13 million, almost 14 million virtual instances spun up. We have over 700,000 active customers, and I'm not selling to you, I'm just saying that people really like this thing. And what we found out is that people are telling us we need other things. And the first thing is storage. We will be introducing a block device here. And if anyone here has any questions about block devices, actually raise your hand, Antoine. He is an engineer who works on our storage product. We will be introducing block storage, and you know, I think in the summer. But we have people running it right now, and we are signing up more people to demo this and use it. I actually use it myself. I beat it up. But we're going to be doing basically block devices. It won't be called block storage, it'll probably be called something else. But think about it, you can have a hard drive that you can actually change the ratio of CPU to disk on your virtual machines or droplets. The next thing that we're exploring is monitoring. And I'm not going to go into exactly what we're going to do, but let's say this, that we have customers that are coming to us and saying that we want to monitor what we have. We want to be able to alert on what we have. We have heard you loud and clear, and there is a product. We're just not quite ready. I'm not the person who's going to introduce it. I don't want to ruin it for them, so I'm not going to do that. And the next thing is this weird acronym. Does anyone here know what this acronym means? Yeah, software-defined networking. And what does that mean? That's this fancy talk to say that we want you to be able to build networks in the way that you want to be able to build networks. And unfortunately, we're not mind readers, and we can't tell you what that is. So we're going to build facilities that will give you things like firewalls on demand, networks on demand, whatever on demand, as long as it's in software-defined networking. That's another product that we're working on right this second. And I was just told, this is how I paid for my plane flight here. This is the advertisement portion of the evening. From now on, it's all me. So, AppOps. Has anyone here heard of AppOps? Because I'm going to say you're lying. Unless you went to, no, actually, my God. Hold on here. Hold on. Let me quit this. I'm gonna have people just talking. So, AppOps. AppOps is short for Application Ops, and where it comes from is, you know, everyone's heard of DevOps, but I can ask three people in this room and they're gonna tell me three different things about AppOps. And that bothers me as someone who writes software. I write things in an orderly way. If I say, what is AppOps, I want you to be able to tell me what they are. So I'm gonna do you a favor and tell you what it is right now. So it's a ladder. It's an orange ladder. It's an orange ladder that I made in Sketch. And I'm not an artist, I'm an engineer, and I'm not good at making these things, so this took me a while. And in a new version of this talk, I have a blue one that took me a while. I didn't even copy and paste it, I remade it. Because you know, us engineers, we re-engineer everything. But you know, that's what it is. So what is AppOps? AppOps is continuous integration. You know what continuous integration is. We have software. You know, you might call it Jenkins. Dave called it Drone, but that's actually wrong. That's not what continuous integration is, but we're not going to talk about that today. We have continuous deployment. We will talk about this one a little bit more. We have logging. Everyone thinks they know what logging is. And they also usually think that logging and metrics are similar, but they're actually not. Logging is telling you what's going to happen or what is happening. Metrics will allow you to actually determine what actually is happening. And I'm not going to use any more words than that because I have a metrics expert here in the front row with Julius right here. So I don't want to embarrass myself. I will just say that I do like what you're doing and it is the future. And the next piece is error handling, but it's also a whole bunch of other things. So you see that I have five items here that I think about AppOps. And really what it is the science of moving your software from development to production. I'm not talking about operations people, I'm not talking about software developers, I'm just talking about people moving things from here to here in a very nice way. So, continuous development. What does this look like? Well, we have some goals. And the goals are, whose team here has a cowboy, a lovely lady, and a clown? I mean, I work on teams that have had clowns and cowboys. I'm sure everyone has. And really what's happening here is that this team of developers wants to produce something. And it doesn't matter what it is. That's why it has a question mark on it. But it's going to be an application. It could be something like, it could be a database service. It could be something like this. It could be a Node app. It could be, you know, for people who still don't do Ruby, it could be a Ruby app. It could be a Go app. It could be a Rust app. It could be whatever you want it to be. It does not matter. You're taking it from development, you're moving it to production. But what you want to do is you want to move it to an environment. And what happens if, you know, the cowboy takes times off? Because, you know, when you cowboy code all the time, it actually is kind of tiring. Does everyone here know what cowboy coding is? All right, you know, let me go back one second. There are a lot of developers out there who just think that, you know, their development machine is a gun. And they walk around taking out this problem, taking out this problem. Who needs tests? Tests are for people who don't want to move fast. And they move, and they're shooting, and they're shooting, and they're shooting, and they're shooting. And guess what? Whatever happens behind them doesn't matter because they've already ridden off to the sunset. That's why the cowboy coder is left. So you're moving this question mark to production, and you know it's production because it's blue and it has a cloud. But what happens if you fire that first whole team because guess what? They obviously don't know what they're doing, and you hired a guy with a hat, you hired a firefighter, and you hired a knight. Because guess what? That's what we do. We're software developers. We love all kinds. But they still need to move that software to production. And what happens if you now introduce a new environment? What are you going to do? And the whole purpose of this talk is to make sure that you're not taking your software and throwing it into the toilet. And this is me just trying to help you because I sleep better at night knowing that I help someone not throw their software development into the toilet. So, what? And I'm seeing all your faces, you're like, what is this guy talking about? But it's not really what are you talking about, it's not what are you deploying. And I'll give you a whole bunch of things that you can do later, but I'm gonna start, I'm a parent, and I'm gonna start with what I talk to my children. I'm gonna tell you what not to do first, just so we can set the ground rules up. So first here, you're not deploying Git Master. And if I ask you all to raise your hands, don't do it because I don't want to embarrass anyone in here. A lot of you deploy Git Master. And I'll tell you why that's not a good idea in a second. Now, don't deploy Tarball. I've seen companies that just say, you know, we'll take that, we'll put it in a Tarball, and then we'll just throw it off to production. And I know there's probably some Windows people in here said we don't use Tarballs, it applies to zip files as well. And then, you know, then we have a Java people in here, well, they said, well, I make wars and jars. And I'm saying, well, guess what? A war and a jar is a zip file, so it's still the same thing. Stop doing that. And you're probably thinking, well, is Brian telling me not to deploy wars and jars and zip files and Git Master? Well, kind of. But let me tell you what I do want you to do. I want you to deploy an artifact. And don't create a service called artifacts, put everything in there, and then by definition, it's all artifacts. That's not really what I'm saying. You know what an artifact is? And now we're going to take a segue. This is kind of like Inception here, where I'm giving a talk, and then I'm showing you the slide presenter. I'm showing you like the presenter slide from another talk that I did. But let me tell you what an artifact is. You have a commit, you have some kind of test, build process, and you produce an artifact. So really, what is an artifact? Oh, you like that, didn't you? The transition there? Well, it get ref. And it's more explicit than that. If you're using Git, and I'm sure most of you are, deploy a Git tag. And when you build something through your CI service, deploy a tag. Don't just deploy this long SHA-1 of something, because guess what? I can deploy the SHA-1 that's A, B, C, D, E, F, G, or I can just, A, B, C, D, E, F, or I can deploy bad cafe, but which one's first? You don't know. Hopefully you have build numbers that increment either through time or a date. But I noticed that the latest Jenkins actually got rid of the date stuff, so probably the consensus in the real world is to use numbers. Deploy a Docker image. And don't deploy, and you know that goes back to what I was saying before, don't just deploy latest, because what is latest? Latest only exists. Latest is always changing. Deploy your Docker image that you tagged with that version that you came up with earlier. And you know, there's Jenkins plugins to do this. If you come to OSCON in Austin, next month. If anyone's coming, anyone going? Well, I'm sorry. I'm doing a 3 hours like masterclass on how to do this correctly. And I promise there will be lots of code. Or you know what? Deploy whatever you want. But what I'm saying is, what you put into production should have a name. I'm not Speaker, I'm Brian Lyles right now. So you can't just replace me with David, because David was speaking before, and Erica will be speaking next. So we all have names, and you can identify us. Treat your builds the same way. So where are you going to deploy to? I like this picture of Chris Tucker just because, I don't know, what is he thinking? You know what he's thinking? He's thinking that they pay me $40 million to make Rush Hour, and then I just screwed it all up because I thought I was a good actor. That's what he's thinking. But that's not what we're talking about here. We're talking about where you deploy your apps. Well, where can you deploy your apps? There's lots of options. But I'm only going to talk about the cloud. Why? Because the cloud pays me. And explicitly, I'm only going to talk about DigitalOcean because DigitalOcean pays me. But really, what I'm saying is that a lot of us are deploying software into clouds. If you do not have to own your own infrastructure, if you're a startup or anything, use a cloud. I'm saying that you should use DigitalOcean, but I'm not mad at you if you use Google or you use Amazon or Linode or SoftLayer. I will be mad at you if you use a few other ones, but I'm not going to say their names. But I'm saying that don't own your own infrastructure if you don't have to. Most of us are not doing computations that that really matters, that you know the loss that you have for virtual machines is actually a big deal. We take that cost for you, and everybody wins. And you can spin it up and spin it down, so it doesn't matter anyways. So what kind of strategies do we have? Well, first, whenever you're creating a server, when you're creating something, a new application, start with the server. I see so many people going, well, I'm going to have a server that does this, and I'm going to have a server that does that, and then I'm going to have a server that does this. Just start with the server. Put as much software as you can on that one server, and when that server gets filled, make a new server. And then, you know, it's 2016. I can't have a talk where I don't say Docker 5 times. I think I said it twice now. And I think you have to say Docker 5 times in your talk, or the talk people will never let me speak again. So we're going to just say this, Docker. I don't have to say it anymore in this talk. But order plate containers. You can get crazy now. You can just actually install Docker in your machine and deploy Docker that way. Or you can step up and you can Kubernetes everything, because that's what Google's telling us to do these days. But you'll find out really quickly is that it's hard, it's difficult. Do you know that Kubernetes is an API server, there's a controller manager, there's a kubelet, there's a kube proxy, there's a replication something or another, and then there's etcd, and let's say you want to actually encrypt it, then you have to create at least 7 different certificates, and you have to manage your own CA, and who wants to do this? Google makes it super easy because guess what, they write it, and they have like more developers that are in this, probably in this city, I don't know. I'm just kidding, but they have a lot of developers and a lot of money. They can do these kinds of things. But for us people who actually have real problems to solve and we don't have unlimited amounts of money, guess what? We can't Kubernetes everything. But I will say, explore it. Your answer is somewhere between a server and crazy Kubernetes. I do like Kubernetes. You should try it out. But if it doesn't work, don't feel bad. But start out as simple as possible, please. That's all I'm asking. But then again, you know, I'm telling you, just try everything. I am the person that will try everything. Even if I know it doesn't work, let's try it. It doesn't matter. And you know, if the test passes, we'll just keep it in there. We'll let the next person figure it out. So how are we going to do this? This is a little picture of Little Wayne and Drake. And I don't know why I put this picture in here. I know I did. In the United States, there's a commercial right now, it's a Samsung commercial, I think, and Lil Wayne is just pouring champagne on his cell phone to show that it is waterproof. And actually, it's funny, in little letters it says, this phone is water resistant. And I'm just thinking, this has to go into a talk. And that's why Drake is looking at him like, what? But how do you deploy? Think about this. I'm sure that no one in here is copying their server assets by hand. You know, if your deploy process says, a script that you wrote says SCP to here, you know, maybe there's going to be a bigger problem. I'm looking at you. Is this something that's going on? Is this a thing? Yeah. And that's pretty common. But we need to think past this. How do we deploy softwares? I'm sure you've automated something. I mean, automation is the key. Automation is actually the answer to every one of our problems right now. But really, have you automated? And I'm going to say to some of you who say that you have, I don't really believe you. And believe it or not, that is a little tiny heart emoticon under there. And it's just because I still love you. Even though you're not automated yet and you're not all the way there, I still love you. And remember, a deployment is more than moving a server, moving your app from A to B. And I should explain this a little bit more. We deploy our software, we move our software from whatever repository they sit in or whatever artifact bin they sit in to production. But there's a lot of things that need to happen afterwards. And the first thing is notifications. Who are you notifying? How are you notifying? What happens when you need to roll back? Who needs to know? Do I need to deploy? Can I deploy from the command line? Actually, it's 2016. If you are still deploying from a command line, and you need an expert to run those command line things, you're not quite there yet. Do you have your monitoring in order? When you do the new deployment, are you actually logging or using your metrics to actually put there's a new version on these servers. Who knows these things? Or do you have to go ask, well, we're in Germany, what's a good German name?
Klaus.
What version of software is on the server? I don't know. Well, there we go. Now we're still hurting. We should have tools for this. So what about super duper automated deploys? Think about this. So this right here is one of DigitalOcean super duper automated deploys, but the joke goes is that, you know, I asked the lawyers what I could show on a slide. And they gave me this. But you know, actually it's funny. We're not actually that kind of company. I just thought it was a funny joke to do this. But here's what I will show you. And I was super good at redacting all the server names except for one. But it doesn't matter because you can't get to it anyways. But what we are trying to move to, and we are doing this DigitalOcean, and I am encouraging people to do this. And in the workshops that I put on, we deploy from our we deploy from Slack. And I'm not saying that to use Slack because it's kind of scary that they've raised $200 million, $3.2 billion US valuation, and they own everybody's data. It's kind of scary. And if you go back to like 2014, where they changed their terms of service, it basically said whoever owns the account can actually read everything in there. And you're like, oh man. But still, this is just an analog. I like Slack because it's free and I can show it to people. But what the good thing is that anyone at our company can go into this chat room, and we actually have it enabled. Not everybody can do this, but you can go in and you can actually type .deploy something to something, and guess what? It'll be deployed. All your logs will show up. When it screws up, it'll show up. And the cool thing is that DigitalOcean is about, we're over 250 people now, but there are more than 100 people who are not in the office. As a matter of fact, Antoine's here, Vitor's here, Brian, Erica, David, none of us actually work in New York City. We're actually in the United States and Amsterdam and Canada and here in Berlin now. So we're all over the place. So we don't want to have these things happening on someone's command line. I actually encourage people to build these tools. And if you're looking for these things, wait about 2 months and look on my GitHub. I have ideas. So how are we going to do this? Who here is a real hip-hop fan? Who is this? All right, that was a test. No, it's Redman. Redman's the best rapper alive. You just don't understand this. And I just like his face. This is how I feel when I see people who aren't automating. But how do you deploy or handle your deploys over time? Well, here's the cool thing is canary builds. I actually went looking on the internet for the first people talking about canary builds. I know Google talks about it a lot. Everyone here know about canary builds? Raise your hand if you don't, because I love this story. All right. This is kind of gory. If you're squeamish, just close your ears. The story goes that miners would actually take canaries, and they would dig these mines, and they would take canaries, and they would release canaries into the mine. If the canaries came back, it was safe to go into the mine. If not, you know, maybe something, you know, bad pocket of gas or something. But we can do something like this. It's not so evil in our production. Is that when we're releasing a new version of the software, what we can actually do is we can actually release one instance running this new piece of software. And we can see how it works in production. We'll send a little bit of traffic to it. And if it works, then we can actually remove all the rest of the pieces. So here's a problem. I'm encouraging people to separate, 100% separate your states from your things that don't have state. Most of your applications shouldn't have state. They talk to databases and they store databases, but that particular application instance goes away, who cares? So here's the thing, here's the easy one. Find a DBA, let them handle the hard pieces, and I said them, not him, and then you just care about your applications. And whenever they die, you just deploy a new version. It's actually the win for all of us. And here we are, we're moving on. So we're now going to talk about rolling with the homies. I was born in 1976. So I was actually coming of age at the perfect time to see Clueless, the movie, and appreciate it for all of its beauty, and Brittany Murphy before she died. But there was a section where they had this song where they were talking about rolling with the homies, but it has nothing to do about what I'm talking about. What I'm talking about is failure, and what happens whenever your deploys fail. So just something to think about. Your deploys will fail. Either they'll fail in process, or they'll fail after you load it up and you realize somebody put something in there to delete everything. So what do? Well, you have three choices. You can roll back. You can fail forward, as Etsy described from Coda's Craft, or you can just panic and cry like Michael Jordan. But we're not going to talk about any of those, so we're going to talk about failing forward first. Failing forward. This is an interesting thing. Basically, what Etsy has said is that they are so confident in their data management processes that whenever they release a bad piece of code, instead of going back to the previous release of code, they actually just code a fix and then push a fix. But Etsy also says they deploy to production hundreds of times a day, and everybody in the company does it. So maybe they figured out something. But for us regular people, we're going to roll back. Because the thing is that if someone pushes out a breaking build and you don't know why it's broken, you probably know what the last version is, and you probably should not be doing state changes and push it at the same time. Rails has steered us wrong. We're saying, oh, you just think of migration as you deploy. It's all good. Look, what's gonna fail? But really, what I'm telling people to do is not lean back, but actually roll back. That's actually a funny joke. There's a Fat Joe song where it's like, lean back. Sorry. One thing I want you to do is here, I want you to separate the church and the state. We talk about this a lot in the United States. Never happens. But what we can do is separate our code from our state. And really, when I say state, I don't mean the state of something. I mean basically data that is stateful versus data that is not stateful. So state is not stateful of things like caches, but your databases, whether you're a NoSQL person or a SQL person, it does not matter. Separate those changes from your code deploys. Think about feature flags. You should be able to change. You should be able, when your databases get big, you're not going to be, unless you run certain types of schemas or certain types of databases, you're not going to be able to change your schema. If you have a row, if you have a table with, you know, 150 million records in there, and you want to alter it, it's going to take some time. And you know, there's tools out there, but do that online and let it take a long time. And then whenever that feature is there, then you can enable that feature flag for that new feature, and you don't have to do no control for that. So why are we doing this? Why do we want to do all this? Well, really, what I'm trying to get people doing, and notice this talk was super not technical, for the reason that I'm trying to, you're thinking Brian's like you're cracking all these jokes, but I've actually told you about 30 things that you're going to think about when the next time you do these things. I'm actually putting all these things in line to talk about building a continuous deployment pipeline. And like I said, the previous slides were just basically the filler to get you to where I really want you to be. So how do we start with this? Well, the first thing you want to talk about is cows versus pets. Anyone know about this one? Chad Ballard, actually, is he still the Berlin president at Wunderlist? I think he's still here, yeah. He coined this term called cattle versus pets. And basically what he said is we have some servers that are cattle, and we have some servers that are pets. That actually makes no sense. Well, let me tell you the difference. You give pets names. When pets fall down, you take them to the vet. But the thing is that we don't give cattle names. We give them ear tags. And generally cattle is for, they're taken off the slaughter. And I actually hate this analogy, but basically saying is that we should think of our software stacks and our servers as cattle. We should not give them names. We should, whenever they get sick, we take them out of production, we take them out of rotation, we rebuild them. Or if you're in the cloud, you just get a new instance. And instead of having these pets, and everyone here has pets, who here has a server named Zeus? Or, you know, I'm not gonna go with other names, but you know, when you start giving a server a name and you don't even start, and that's all you do is refer to that server by name, you're starting to treat that server like a pet. But I'm not sure this all works, and I'm actually trying to introduce new words into our vernaculars. And I'm thinking of servers versus services. And really what I'm saying is stop focusing on the servers, start focusing on the services. These words are very similar, but the whole point is I care about what I'm running, the piece of software that I'm running, those endpoints. Everything else is an implementation detail, and especially if you're in an LLM language, you realize that we hide everything that we don't want to see behind encapsulation. And for you, you should be hiding your server behind encapsulation. You grow your servers, you grow your services by spinning up new, by creating more instances. And when you run out of capacity, you create more servers, but you don't bring up servers and services at the same time. They're different. So we deploy services, and we realize that servers are an implementation detail. So I spent all those slides just to get us here. So here's what success is. This is why, and you realize, this is why people talk about Docker, and this is why people talk about Kubernetes and Mesos and all these other things, because what they're enabling people to do is forget about the servers. We're trying to create the operating data center operating system, and I know that's what Mesos VCOS is, but it really is the operating system of data center. We want to treat our whole data center or our whole implementation at DigitalOcean, we want to treat that as one thing. We just deploy things to it and they just go where they need to be. And that's why Kubernetes is so important. It's still hard. 2017 is the year of Kubernetes, I swear to you. So, this is Ashton Kutcher. and dude, where's my car? And I wrote, and then what? And then I just started laughing to myself because I also came up in a very important time where dude, where's my car? Have you ever seen this movie? There's a scene where he's at this restaurant and he's ordering food and the lady goes, and then? And then he's like, no. And then? No. She's like, no more and then, no more and then. It's really funny. You should go rent it. So what's left? After we finish out how to do deployments, I'm going to give you a spoiler alert. I submitted this talk to Collision that I'm going to do next week. But I was like, this is pretty funny. I'm going to share it with my German friends as well. And in my talk description, I told everyone that I would talk about deployments and then I would give you ideas of things to do with all your free time since you're not worrying about the deployments. So the first thing you can do is troll Twitter. I find that if you learn how to troll Twitter properly, you can get hours of entertainment off one tweet. So the funny thing is I wrote this talk and I was thinking, well, how can I troll Twitter? So I just wrote this thing. And I said, what if all these new op schemes like Docker and Kubernetes are only your roots? And I'm laughing as I'm typing this, like. And then instantly, people are like. Actually, this was only a few minutes before I typed this. It's actually way higher than this now. And I'm thinking, are you guys serious? I mean, we kid and we don't like Docker and Kubernetes now. But realizing that Docker is probably going to be one of the biggest package formats. Docker has enabled a lot of people to do a lot of great things. So think about it. It must be somewhat of a good idea if Microsoft is saying, we are going to do this. I mean, believe Microsoft, they're running Bash and Windows right now. Things are changing. So another thing you can do, and I'm more serious about this, is you can spend your time mentoring. I like to find people that are trying, and I think they are succeeding, but I think everyone needs someone who has seen what they've seen before. So go find someone and teach them a lesson. And not like beat them up or anything, but mentor them. Another thing you can do is you can sit down and for a day or two, you can create 80 slides and you can entitle it, How to Troll an Audience for 30 Minutes. Thank you.
We have Erica Heide coming up next. Erica is a software engineer working at DigitalOcean. She has a passion for writing and for open source. She's published the Vagrant Cookbook and created a few different open source projects like Fansible, PlaceEvent, and DevHuman. When she's away from her keyboard, she enjoys watching TV series and making art. And I encourage all of you to come by and say hello and to chat with us afterwards about technical things and non-technical things. And if anyone's interested in organizing this meetup starting next month, please come chat with me. I know several of you have gotten in touch with me already saying you would like to organize. We'd very much like to chat with you and put you in touch with each other so you can co-organize this meetup and take it forward. So, thoughts on this meetup so far? Any feedback? So shy, the Germans.
No, they're not shy.
No?
You just wait till after this.
Okay. Good evening, everybody. Thanks for coming for this first DigitalOcean Berlin meetup. It's really great to be here. Oops, yeah, I'm sure. I'm Erica Heide, and I am originally from Brazil, but I live in Amsterdam, and I work as a software engineer at DigitalOcean. So today I'm going to talk about Ansible. So I'm going to start with a quick overview about Ansible. So Ansible is a very simple and straightforward configuration management tool. And it was created with focus on simplicity, and it uses a very straightforward language, YML, something that developers are probably used to, most of them. It doesn't have a specific syntax, keys on their cells or anything like that. And one thing that is very important about Ansible is that it uses a agentless architecture, which means that it doesn't require any kind of agent to be installed on the nodes that you want to control. So you really just need to install Ansible on the controller machine, which can be like your working machine, and then you will be able to control 1-200s of servers. And it uses SSH for that. So you really just need a proper SSH connection, and then you will be able to run Ansible. So it also has a huge collection of built-in modules, which is cool because with other tools you usually have to search for third-party modules or extensions, and many of these things are already implemented built-in on Ansible. It has a great community and very popular on GitHub nowadays. So how does it look like? How do you use it? So first, if you want to automate something with Ansible, you need basically two things. You need an inventory file and you need a playbook. So the inventory file is where you will list the machines that you want to control, the servers. And you can also have virtual machines in your local machine. You can control remote machines. You can also run Ansible locally to provision your working machine. If you have like a new, you buy a new laptop and you can run the provisioning to set up your development environment locally. This is an example of an inventory file. So by default, you have the you have a default inventory file, this location, it is ansible/host, but you can also have inventory files for projects. So this is a very straightforward INI file, and you have two groups here, dev and prod. You can have multiple machines in each group, and when running Ansible, you can specify which group you want to run the playbook against, or a common as well. You can run also commons. You can also run like only on one specific server or on all servers from the inventory. And then there's the playbook. So this is a very simple playbook, just to show you how it looks like in general. It's a YML file, and then it starts with host all. So this is just telling Ansible that you want to run that playbook on all machines from the inventory file. You can also limit this to a specific group of hosts or a specific host. Become true is a new way to say that you want to use sudo to run tests. In previous versions of Ansible, you would use sudo. But this is just to, it's a privileged escalation. And then we have the tests. The tests are listed as a YML array. And then we have a name just for output. So it can, when you run the automation, you will see all the steps that are being executed. And then we have APT here. We are using a module. APT is a module to abstract package management for Debian systems, Debian Ubuntu systems. So first we update the cache, and then we install Nginx. this is a very simple playbook, because usually we'll be using much more resources, like variables, loops, conditionals, templates. Those are all things that you can use to make your playbooks more versatile. And there's also Ansible Vault, which is very useful for sensitive data. If you have like, which is common, you have like API tokens and things that you don't want to be public, then you can use Ansible Vault, and it's very easy to use. And you can encrypt that information, and you can commit this even for a public repositories, and it's going to be encrypted. So I want to show a hands-on, because that's what the main thing of the talk. I'm going to start by creating a new droplet here. I'm going to create a very basic droplet just to, oops. And then I'm gonna add my SSH key and Ansible test. So I'm just to show you a like a clean droplet how it's gonna be. So it's creating, and I'm gonna show you the playbook that I'm going to run. So this is the playbook. I'm going to explain each part of it. So it starts with the same thing that we saw before. Goes all, become true. And then we have the bars. This is different. So this is for defining variables. Basically, we have a section on the playbook where you can define variables. And then these variables are global. You can use them on included files, on templates. There are also other ways to declare variables, but this is the simplest way. So we have packages. I'm just listing here the packages that I want to install, and then I'll be using this later. And I'm defining a message that I'm going to use in a template. So then we have the tasks. It starts with the APT cache update, and then I am installing the packages. So the difference here is that instead of creating one task for each package that I want to install, I can use a loop, and this is how Ansible implements loops. You have the option with items, and then you pass a array for this parameter, for this option. And then Ansible will loop through the values of this array and execute the task. So instead of creating one task for each package that you want to install, you can just use an array. And next, we have a task for changing the default HTML file, the default index file for Nginx. We installed Nginx, and now I'm setting a custom index.tpl, index.html file, using a template, which is located in the same directory as my playbook. So this is the template, a built-in module. You pass a source and a destination in the remote machine, and that's basically it. And then we have the notify here. So the notify serves to notify a service that you want it to be restarted. And this actually notifies a handler. So handlers are the equivalent of services for Puppet and Chef. We define handlers to manage service, to stop, restart, and start services. And then we have a handler here to restart Nginx. And that's what we call from the previous task when you use the notify option. So this is the whole thing. And yeah, same time. So I will first get this IP address here. So this is a new machine, it's a Ubuntu machine, and so
you can close that in the bottom corner,
So we have here four files. We don't need this demo, but we'll try actually. So we have three files. We have inventory file, we have a playbook, which is demo.yml, and we have the template. So the inventory file, I have to edit actually. So, and I will add, So this is the inventory file, and this is just the IP from the new droplet that I just created, and then we have the playbook, which is the same that I showed in this slide, and we have the template file. So the template is just a HTML file, and we have a variable here. We are using the message variable that we define inside the playbook. So it should show a message. So Ansible has a few different commands. Ansible by itself is for running ad hoc commands. So you can run any sort of commands in the machines, the same way that you run the provisioning. You can also run specific commands. So for running commands, you can do Ansible, and then you have to specify which machine you want to run. And than the command. So I'm going to run a ping. I'm using the module ping, that's why it's slash m. And for this this demo, I'm going to use my SSH key as a root, so I'm going to provide dash u root. But normally, you should be using a regular user with pseudo privileges, please. It's just for the demo, because it's easier. So this is just for doing a ping, and then it will show success, so you know that you have a connection, and the SSH connection is working. You can also do all sorts of things, all sorts of commands that you want to run. But let's run the playbook. So for running the playbook, you do Ansible playbook, and then it's similar. You pass the inventory. You don't need to pass a specific group because you already have in the playbook. We have host all, so it will already run in all hosts by default. And the playbook and the user. So Ansible by default, it will try to run as the current user. So the current user you are logging in. As I just created a droplet, I don't have yet a user there. I just have roots with my SSH key. That's why I'm using this user root. But yes, you should be using a regular user. So first it starts play. And then the setup part is fetching information about the server. There is some information that you can use in the playbooks, like network interfaces, IP addresses, hosts, and things like operating system that the server is running. And then we start with the tasks. So first, we have the we have the APT cache update. First, you see that some tasks have OK and some have the change status. So the update APT cache has OK because it didn't change any state on the server. It did update the APT cache, but it didn't change anything actually. The other tasks, however, they changed the state on the server. That's why they show changes. So we have installed packages, and then you can see the packages that were installed. And then we have a change nginx index file, so it should be applied. And then at the end of the play, we have running handler because we notified the service. So one thing interesting about the handlers is that for performance reasons, they only run at the end once, because often you don't need to be restarting services all the time. You just need to restart once at the end. So if you go now to that server, oops, I'm not sure if it is command
to the left of the spacebar. There you go.
So we have now, so we applied everything worked well, and the demo worked. Yay! So you can see that. So you can see that the actual parameter, the message, the variable that we created in the playbook was applied in the template, and everything worked, and it's awesome. Okay, so yeah, that is it. If you have any questions, in case you have time for questions. Any questions? You can, if you are shy or something, oh, there's no question.
Are there any specific system requirements?
Ansible for the controller machine, there's only one thing, it doesn't run on Windows.
Do we need any special software on
this
server?
No, on the servers you don't need to install anything. You just need SSH.
So it executes raw commands?
Yes, you can.
It executes some other language?
Anything that you can, like pretty much anything that you can do manually via SSH, you can automate using it. And it will be just using SSH for that. So yeah, it can do a lot of things. Well, by the way, it doesn't run on Windows, but you can always create a virtual machine with Ubuntu and run from it. So there's always a way.
Actually about the client, the server requirements. I really experienced because we run really a lot of microservices on minimal servers, and it actually requires Python on the server.
Oh yeah, that is that. I'm sorry. Yeah, it requires Python. Just that. Yeah. But yeah, if you write regular servers, usually already have it more recent version, so yeah. Any more questions? If you are shy or something, you can ask me afterwards, it's okay. All right, so I think it's we are running out of time. And if you, I'm Erica, I don't read it. If you need it, if you also prefer to send an email or something, that's my email. So thank you very much and enjoy the rest of the day.
We ought to give question and answer time for Brian. Does anyone have any questions for Brian?
I wasn't going to answer them anyways.
All right, well, thank you so much, everybody, for coming. We have drinks, so please enjoy them for the next, I think, 20, 30 minutes or so. We have the wedding till 9. Lovely having everybody here. Again, thank you so much for coming. If you would like to organize future meetups, come chat with me. Rock on with future meetups.
Thank you.